How many individuals know, a couple trivia questions. How many folks know what the most common command in the Bible is? Anyone familiar with that trivia? What's the most common command in the Bible?
Love thy neighbor.
Love thy neighbor, no?
No.
Love thy neighbor.
That's what the Lord is.
With all your heart, mind. Good, good, yeah. And I thought, go, yeah. All good guesses, and I thought that myself, that the most common command was something along those lines, but did you know the most common command is fear not, do not be afraid? Now, tellingly also, do you know what the most common promise is? Go ahead, take a stab, or not right.
I will always be with you.
And I can't wonder if the two are tied together in some way. Don't you think sometimes our fears get in the way so we have trouble trusting in God? Aren't we sometimes afraid, and because we're afraid, we have trouble believing that God is good and has our highest good in mind. We have trouble believing that God's presence is with us. Today's parable from the 25th chapter of Matthew, I think, has quite a bit to say about fear. It has quite a bit to do with just those two commands. It's a parable with which many of us are familiar. A little background. Jesus has already entered Jerusalem riding on the donkey. And so Jesus is hanging around Jerusalem, and he knows the end is coming. And so Jesus starts to talk about some of those end time things. In fact, he's gone into the temple and he's wept over Jerusalem, and the disciples, as they so often do, don't get it. They're mesmerized with the temple and the big stones, and they say to Jesus, well, look at these big stones. And that opens up for Jesus to give them a long dialogue. In Matthew's gospel, there are these long sermons, the first of which is the Sermon on the Mount. So Jesus gives him a long talk, and he starts by talking about how Jerusalem's going to be destroyed, and not one stone will be left upon the other. And then Jesus seizes the opportunity. He talks not only about the destruction of Jerusalem, but then he parlays this into talking about the coming judgment when God returns in glory. And to do so, he does as he so often does, by telling a story. In fact, a number of stories. Right before this, he tells the story of the 10 virgins or the 10 maidens. We know that parable. Remember, they go out, bridegroom comes, and they don't have oil. We know that story, and he says the kingdom of God's going to come. And right after this, we know the story of the goats and the sheep, right? How he's going to separate the goats from the sheep. And then sandwiched right in between is this parable of the talents. I think most of us are familiar with that parable, aren't we? How many of us have heard it before, or maybe heard a sermon or two? Yeah, we're very familiar with that. It's a story of a rich master who entrusts his slaves with some money, and he goes off on a trip, one with 5 talents, another with 2 talents, and the third with 1 talent. So he entrusts with them. And then after a long time, he returns to discover that those with the 5 talents and the 2 talents have invested them and doubled their money. But the one slave, who only had 1 talent, what does he do with that talent? He buries it. He sits in it. And he buries it in the ground. And he receives a harsh punishment. And that's kind of the way the parable unfolds. Now, for this morning's purpose, what I find most revealing is verses 24 and 25. If you have your Bibles, you want to open to verses 24 and 25. I think they're really the hinge verses of this particular parable. Notice the response of the one who received the single talent. Starting in verse 24, he says, then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward saying, Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid. And I went and hid your talent in the ground. So here, have what belongs to you. Other translations say that he was frightened, that he was scared. In other words, he was full of fear, or as we say, fearful. he was mesmerized by his fears. He was like frozen, like a deer in headlights. And fears often do that to us, don't they? Anybody here know, or maybe you yourself, have a fear that just causes you to stop in your tracks? Maybe a fear of water. Have you known somebody who has a fear of water? Or a fear of flying? I remember my mom was terribly frightened of water. Sometimes the water would only be knee deep. And we'd be on the docks back in Minnesota. And as a young kid, I'd go by mom and I'd shake that dock. And she'd say, oh, stop that, stop that. That's the way fears kind of work. In fact, fears in excess turn into phobias. And if you went to the psychological dictionary, you find out that there are literally over 500 different phobias. That's what fears do to us. Myself, I have a fear of height. Well, if I see my children even on the edge of something that's really high, I just like, ooh, ooh. We all have fears, and fears tend to do that to us. In fact, there's an interesting story about one Alfred Krupp. He was a successful businessman in Germany right before World War I. He made armaments. But ironically, even though he made armaments for death, he himself had a fear of death. So much so that if you mentioned death in his midst, he would get angry at you. And he would leave immediately. If his employees ever mentioned death in his presence, he would fire them at once. In fact, there's a story told that one time, he was at a relative's place, and an individual died tragically, quickly, unexpectedly, and he fled from the house, never to return again. And he certainly didn't make it to the funeral. That's the sort of fear he had. His wife, how many of us are married and know that wives can sometimes do this? His wife gave him the business. Guys, you know what I'm talking about? That he behaved inappropriately, he became angry and he left her. And they no longer lived together. That's the sort of fear. His fear was so great as death approached, he offered his doctor no small amount of money at that time, $1 million if he could prolong his life. I don't know how you'd measure that, but anyhow, needless to say, he died. He didn't defeat death. How often are our fears like that? How often do our fears just cause us to stop dead in our tracks? How often do our fears do something to our spiritual life? Now keep that in mind as we go back to our parable. It's interesting to note that the master has a great deal of confidence in these slaves. He has a great deal of faith in these slaves. Modern commentators point out that a talent was equivalent to 10,000 denarii. And one denarius was the equivalent of a day's wages. So if we were to bring it up into modern terms, let's say $100 a day, that's just a little bit over 12 bucks an hour, not a big amount. So we'd say that a day's wages was $100. So the one with five talents was given the equivalent of $5 million. The one with two talents was given the equivalent of $2 million. And the one with one talent was given the equivalent of $1 million. No small amount of money. Demonstrates a great deal of confidence. And notice as well that the master, he doesn't say you have to make so much profit. He just trusts them, doesn't he? In fact, he could say that profit was easily at hand in the ancient world as much as it is today. What do we often say? If you've got money, it's easy to make money, isn't it? So true. If you've got money, it's easy to make money. It was common in the ancient world, and it's common in the world today. Take that $1 million. Let's say if you put it in the bank at 3% interest, he could get 3%, right? What are CDs, Gene? What are CDs paying now? 1%? Well, let's give him a little more because I'm math and you're going to mess me up if we change it at this point. 3% it is. Certainly with $1 million, he could get 3%, right, Gene? You could chop that around. Okay, 3%. 1 year, if the master was away for 1 year, he would make 30,000. There we go. If he's away 5 years, he'd make 150,000. If he was away 10 years, it would be $300,000. Easy to make money if you've got money. Even if you sit on it, just invest in the bank. In fact, Jesus says that the master says those very words, and yet the slave will do none of it, will he? He just sits on it. He won't do a darn thing. He does nothing, and he'll risk nothing, and he gets nothing in return. He has what modern business people call, he has a problem with risk tolerance. How many of us have heard that in the business world? Risk tolerance. You know what that is? That just means if you invest your money, how much tolerance do you have for risk? Are you willing to risk it? In fact, you go on the internet and you could find probably a half dozen or a dozen or more surveys that will determine your risk tolerance. Let's see, I think Bill might have moved it on me, but it's right here. Here's one survey. Risk tolerance. Answer this question. This will give you a sense of your risk tolerance. You just won $10,000 in the lottery. Now, we good Methodists don't do lottery, do we? If you do win anything in the lottery, remember to give it to the church. You didn't hear that. You just won $10,000 in the lottery. Congratulations. What do? You run out to the nearest casino, sit down at the blackjack table, and try to double your money. That's one. You speak to your father's stockbroker and decide to invest in the stock market. That's two. You put your money under your mattress or in a nice safe certificate of deposit. What do? That gives you a sense of your risk. And the questions go on, right? You're sitting at that blackjack table at Trump's Taj Mahal Casino. You've been gambling. You started with $10,000, but you've lost $4,000 so far. How much more are you prepared to lose to win that $4,000 back? Nothing. You quit now and go home with the $4,000, or will you risk $2,000, or will you risk more than $4,000? Another question. Question three. You decide that gambling is not the way to go. You want to get some advice on what to do with your money, so you read as much as you can, watch the news, and invest based upon your research. Or you ask the blackjack dealer from the table you just got up from. Or you seek out the advice of a stockbroker. Question four, you finally decided to invest the money. You invest in what? Blue chip stocks, U.S. Treasury bonds, a high-tech computer company. Question five, you are now a stock market junkie. You are watching your new investment. You believe that the value of your investment will increase. You believe that the value of your investment will decrease. You believe that equally the value of your investment will increase or decrease. And we could go on and on. That's the sort of questions to determine your risk tolerance. The point is, the guy with one talent has no risk tolerance, does he? Just buries it. Puts it under the mattress, so to speak. Buries it and does nothing with it. And you see, the parable is talking about a faith dimension. Because in the parable, who's the master that's going to return? Help me out. It's God or Jesus, right? It's God or Jesus. So the parable has a spiritual dimension to it. So how are you and I, when we raise that spiritual question, what is our risk tolerance when it comes to the talents that God has given you and me? How do we invest our money for things of God? John Wooden, the great basketball coach from UCLA, used to ask his players and his students a question like this. He'd say, what if somebody gave you $1 every second of every day? That's well over $86,000 a day. How would you spend it? He said, would you spend it on houses and cars? Vacations, me, myself, and I, or would you invest on more eternal things? Things of lasting value, things of character, things of God. But let's move out of the realm of money. Talents is partly money, But let's think of talents more broadly. Let's think of talents as all those gifts that you and I are given. All those gifts. Some of those gifts we inherit. We have strength. We have brains. Some of those gifts we develop. Some of those gifts are simply because I was born at this time and in this place. Have you ever asked yourself, how different would my life be if I would have been born in a two-thirds world country where clean water was a luxury? We're gifted with clean water, aren't we? A roof over our heads. A warm place on days like today. Just because we were born in the United States of America, how about the freedoms we have? And then there just are some gifts that we just happen to be at the right place at the right time. Have to do with luck, right? Just happen to be there when your number is called on that lottery ticket. Just happen to be there. It's luck. Think of gifts in all of those terms. In fact, here are some of the things I'm thinking about. Think of gifts like health and strength and creativity and foresight and opportunity and freedom and intellect and education. How do we use our talents when we define it that way? For ourselves or for God? How often do we, if we're honest, bury our talents? At least when it comes to the purposes and desires of God. How often are you and I like that? Our fears get a hold of us, and we really don't invest. You see, this parable wants you and me to think of our talents as all of those things, and ultimately they belong to God. Father Robert Capon, who's a writer, a theologian, he has a snippet on this parable, and I'm going to paraphrase it. But he says the parable really boils down to this. Here's the meaning of the parable, and he puts it in these terms. Here's what God is saying through the parable. Look, I'm not asking you to make money. I'm asking you to do business, to trust that I mean you well. It doesn't even bother me if you take some risks with the talents I've given you, but instead you remain afraid and do nothing. It's your choice. You play it safe because of some imaginary fear. You trust in your own excuses. And now all you have left is the life you started with, but you are not even going to get that because I'm going to take it from you and give it to others who will do something. I'm doing this for two reasons. First, when I give you a gift, I expect you to do business with it. You must love as you have been loved. You must forgive as you have been forgiven. Second, I'm giving it to others just to prove that I've never cared about results, how much you make with my talents. I've only cared that you do something, that you risk faith. But when you insult me, tell me that you can't trust me enough to take a few risks, it proves you really think I'm cold and harsh and uncaring. That I can never accept because I've told you not to fear and that I'm with you always, over and over and over again. In fact, I proved my love to you on Calvary. You prove when you do nothing that you do not believe in me. Parable that gives us all pause. In fact, we're going to keep this parable before us through this sermon season. We're going to do something kind of crazy. We're going to take a few risks ourselves, and here's the risk. I want you to go home this week and think about some of the talents that you have and some of the ways that you can invest those talents. In fact, when you come back next week, we're going to have out in the narthex in the entryway individuals there with money. You can take as much money out of that pot as you want, within reason. You can take as much money out of that, and you are going to be challenged, and I'm going to challenge the entire congregation, I'm challenging myself to take whatever money we have and invest it. And you can invest it in supplies for pies, and make pies and sell them. Invest your talents that way. You can take your money and you can do multiple of other things. And so we're going to actually, instead of taking an offering, we're going to give you money. How's that for a Sunday, huh? And you take that money, and you will be encouraged to invest it. And then Easter, we're a little late with the snow and everything, maybe the Sunday after Easter, we're going to have a Sunday where we just celebrate. You'll be given little boxes with the money that you've made or the money that you've lost. We're going to take those boxes, those gifts, and we're just going to put them up on the altar. All that money that we raise, we're trusting God in this. All the money we raise will be going to our missions trip that's coming up to the Navajo Nation. And so this week, your homework assignment, what is it, Tom? Take money and invest, but you're not getting the money yet. This week you're going to go home and think about it. Okay. Do you have some talents, you think, Tom? Well, you pray about your talents. I can think of one talent, Tom, just offhand. You could buy some shells, and you could maybe offer a certificate to take somebody out and teach them how to shoot. You can sell that service. That's just one, and I know you have many other talents. So that's an example. So think about your talents this week and how much money you'll take or need, if you need any money. And next Sunday we'll start distributing that money. We're going to have to bring the rest of the church on board because there aren't many of us here this Sunday. So we're going to remind them next Sunday. And then Easter, or maybe the Sunday after Easter, we'll just have to see how the weather goes. We're going to have a Sunday where we celebrate and give our talents back to God. Does that sound pretty wild and crazy?
Yes.
Sound great. A little risky?
Great.
Hey. We take God at His word, that's what we're going to do. So let's pray. Gracious and loving Lord, we thank You for we are a talented lot here at Asbury United Methodist Church. For we know that You give all of us talents. And when we move out of the realm of money, You give us talents in so many, many ways. And so Lord, help us through this Lenten season as we consider our gifts. To discover what our talents are, and then as we invest those talents, we just pray that there would be a harvest. And if there's no harvest, Lord, we know that You value just the risk in itself, and that You don't measure the results. And so help us to be faithful over this coming week, and to be mindful of some of those things that we might do to invest our talents. And we trust You with the increase. We thank You for Your faithfulness to us, and Your love and Your grace, and we do this all in Christ's most precious name. Amen.